Session. So we will keep it simple. I'll just do some nice theorems, nice proofs to show you that whatever we did does have some beautiful results already. Okay. Yeah, but before that, if you recall all the last three lectures which was given by Devakaran, all through there was inherently one result being used. So given any operator or given any matrix A, so I'll interchange, I'll go back and forth between the word matrix and an operator, because we already know that an operator can always be associated to a matrix, that there was an isomer. I'll always interchange these words. So there was inherently one result being used all through, that given any matrix or given any operator, there exists some eigenvalue. We need to know that it is indeed true. What if there are matrices which do not have eigenvalues at all? I had shown you one example in R2 which does not have eigenvalues at all. But there you should remember that it was over real numbers, and the moment we saw that the matrix, same matrix or the same operator is defined over the complex numbers, we did come up with two eigenvalues. So something about the real numbers and the complex numbers is playing a role. So let me make it precise. In fact, towards the end of the last lecture, you did see a small proof about, actually it was hidden, he didn't mention it, but it was hidden in the proof that eigenvalues does exist. So I'll make that notion a bit more specific. Let me begin with a theorem which I had written down towards the end of the previous lecture I gave. I'll just quickly prove it and move on to some interesting results. So let me recall. Let V be a finite dimensional vector space over the complex numbers, and T be an operator or a linear map from V to itself. P has an eigenvalue. Okay. Let's quickly go into the proof. Yeah, I will not rush through this proof. Today I am only going to do two results. So 50% of the time we will spend on this, and 50% of the time we will spend on the next result. Okay. So T has an eigenvalue. So okay. Suppose. So to prove this, pick an element V in the vector space. Okay. Suppose PV is 0. And what does it mean? Yes, so I hear that 0 is an eigenvalue, and we are done. We just needed to show that T has an eigenvalue. That's the intention of this theorem. So let us assume. So let us assume that PV is not 0. So let us consider this particular collection of sets V, TV, T square V, and so on. So, okay. So before I do this, let me just fix some notations. What I will do is T acting on V twice is basically T of V. I will denote it by T square of V. Okay. Similarly, T acting on itself k times. I will denote it as t to the power k. Okay, I'm fixing notations. Somebody should guess what should be t to the power 0. Yes, identity. Okay. Yeah, it's an unfair guess that I asked, but it's okay. I will set t to the power 0 to be identity. And now, suppose p of x is a polynomial. P of x is a0 x, a0 plus a1 x plus dot 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 plus an x to the power n. Then we will denote p of t to be a0 I. So a0 is basically a0 times x to the power 0, right? So this is in some sense x to the power 0. So that's what I is coming here, t to the power 0 plus a1 t plus dot 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 plus an t to the power n. Okay? I'm just extending the notation from here to here. So this is all just notations. There's nothing to be frightened of here. Okay. Okay. So let me ask one more thing. Have you people heard of the fundamental theorem of algebra? Good. So I will just use that theorem. I will just mention it. By fundamental theorem of algebra, if P of X is an element of, okay, let me not use these notations. If P of X is a polynomial, over the complex numbers, this is important. This is not true if we write P of x to be polynomials over reals and consider everything in reals. This is important. C is important. The C being here is important. Okay? Then, actually this is not the fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay. As a consequence of the fundamental theorem of algebra, you can write P of x to be x minus lambda 1 dot 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 x minus lambda n. So I am assuming that degree of this polynomial is, okay, n is already being used here. Let me just change all the n's to m's here so that there will be no confusion. Okay, so I have just changed the degree to m so that I will always use n to denote the dimension of the vector space. So basically if p of x is a polynomial a0, okay, so just for the sake of completion, let me write it as a0 times x to the power 0 plus a1 times x to the power 1 plus up to am times x to the power m. Then, by the fundamental theorem of algebra, I can write p of x to be x minus 1, lambda 1 times x minus lambda 2 up to x minus lambda m, where lambda I are complex numbers. Okay? Okay. So I think now we have all the machinery needed. So this I should have just written before introducing this so that there is no break or discontinuity in the proof. So let me continue. So that is that. Let's continue from here. Okay. So let us recall, what was it? Suppose V is such that TV is 0, then 0 is an eigenvalue of T. And our result is already true. So let us assume that TV is not 0. Okay? Then consider this set. V, TV, T square V and so on. Okay? Suppose, or if, there exists k such that t to the power k v is equal to v. Okay? It means after some power, after taking v, t square v, t cube v, after a certain stage, suppose t to the power k v is equal to v. What does that mean? Actually, I was not really expecting an answer. Good that I am having an answer. What did I hear? Okay, got right. Okay, no problem. We will see what happens. So, I will just rewrite this. I will just rewrite this as e to the power k minus I of v is equal to 0. Correct?
E to the power k v is equal to I of v. Just pulling this to the left. So, it is t to the power k minus I of v is equal to 0.
Right? Now, the notations that I introduced, if p of x is a0 plus a1x plus up to amx to the power m, p of t is a0i plus a1t plus up to amt to the power m. Right? So, let me ask you, this is p of t for what p? That is some polynomial p. So, what is p of x? So, this is equal to p of t for some p, right? What is that? Yeah, yeah, you are correct. What is this? It is x to the power k minus 1. Correct? So, if you consider p of x to be x to the power k minus 1, p of t is exactly equal to t to the power k minus I. Now, let us use fundamental theorem of algebra on x to the power k minus 1. You can write p of x to be, so I will just write it below. So, this is basically p of x, I will write it as x minus zeta 1 dot 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 x minus zeta k. Right? It's a k degree polynomial, there will be k roots, might be, will not be the same actually, these are roots of unity. So, zeta 1 to zeta k, there are k roots of p of x is equal to 0. So, you can find the roots and really write it like this. That's how that's also being done. Anyway, so p of t, so this is p of x. So, let me see, what is p of t now? T minus zeta 1 I times T minus zeta 2 I dot 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 T minus zeta k I. Correct? This is what P of T is. Right? Good. So, we have done all the work. So, basically Tk minus I of V 0 is the same as writing T minus zeta 1 I times T minus zeta 2 I dot 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 T minus zeta k I of V is equal to 0. Correct? T minus zeta k I of V is 0. Okay, so I think I can drop this. So, I would like to remind you which Divakaran just said in the previous lecture. An equivalent formulation of when some vector or when T has an eigenvalue. So, suppose T has an eigenvalue lambda. That means there exists a non-zero vector in V such that T V is equal to lambda V. Right? This is if and only if T minus lambda I V is equal to 0.
this is if and only if the null space of T minus lambda I is not 0.
There is some other element V such that,
or let me write it more clearly, 0 is strictly contained in T minus lambda I.
There are more elements than 0, right? So there is a V also here. So it's not just 0, it's just properly contained. Okay, no need to put it that way. The null space has dimension more than 0, that's what it means, right?
But remember, one more result which we had proved was that
an operator is invertible if and only if the null space is 0.
So this null space is not just 0, there are more elements. That means T minus lambda is not invertible. Yeah, so E is not invertible. So this is another, so if you observe,
at every stage it was an if and only. So you can as well define an eigenvalue like this. An eigenvalue is a scalar lambda such that T minus lambda I is not invertible. You might have started with a definition like this, doesn't matter. You could have just come back, right? Okay, so anyway. So let's see. So what does, let's come back here. Okay, did I need to say all these things? Yes, I needed to say all these things. What is the meaning of T minus zeta 1 I times T minus zeta 2 I up to T minus zeta k I acting on V is equal to 0? That means at some stage, whatever is inside is becoming 0. So suppose T minus zeta k I acting on V is 0. Then, by this observation, we have zeta k is an eigenvalue.
Implies zeta k is an eigenvalue. And again, we are done.
Suppose t minus zeta k I of V is some other vector, W1.
Suppose this is W1, which is not equal to 0.
Then we will consider T minus zeta 1 I up to T minus zeta k minus 1 I acting on W. That is also 0. The right hand side does not change. Then we will see if T minus zeta k I, zeta k minus 1 I of W is 0. So, okay, I'll rub this. Oh no, don't need to. Let's rub this part because this is a case which is closed. So, suppose W1 is not 0.
Then T minus zeta 1 I times up to T minus zeta k minus 1 I of W1 is equal to 0.
Just calling this vector as W, that's all. T minus zeta I is a linear operator from V to itself. So in particular, it will send V to some element which I am calling as W1. Now let's do the same idea. Is T minus zeta k minus 1 of I, zeta k minus 1 I of W1 0?
If T minus zeta k minus 1 I of W1 is 0, here it is then done. I'll write that.
Okay. Then again done. Why?
Because zeta k minus 1 is an eigenvalue.
Suppose not. Then we will call this. Suppose not.
Then we will call this W2.
And we will do the analysis again. At the max, what can happen? If at any stage it is not 0, we will come to some W at the max. Let me not be casual. Let me say, in the worst case scenario, if you are repeating these steps and at every stage T minus zeta k I or T minus zeta j I, let me write it. Why not? Suppose not. Okay.
let us repeat the process.
Suppose
let us repeat this process. IE WK WJ rather V equal to P minus zeta J minus K minus J of WJ WK minus J minus 1 I of WJ minus 1. Let's do this
and see if WJ minus 1 is 0. This repeat can, this process can repeat at the max till this can repeat at the maximum
till J is equal to N.
Why? Because, I shouldn't have rubbed it, because we had T minus zeta 1 I times T minus zeta 2 I dot 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 T minus zeta K I of V is 0. So here you will get W1, here you will get W2, here you will get WNK minus 1. Correct? But whatever it is, finally at least should be 0. At some point of time it is 0, then we are already done. But if this is going till, okay, N is not the right index here, I am very sorry, it should be K minus 1. So IE T minus zeta 1 of WK here zeta K minus 1 is K minus 1 is equal to 0. IE zeta k is an eigen.
Zeta 1 is an eigen value.
So you should observe one thing here. The only requirement we had in this particular part of the proof was writing down P of t as t minus zeta 1 I times t minus zeta 2 I plus up to t minus zeta ki. If we can do it, if we can write p of t this way, we are done. Okay, so I don't know if you really recall what are we doing here. We were considering the case when t to the power k v is equal to v. This is the case, right? This is the case that we were considering.
Suppose, so if this is the case, if t to the power k v is equal to v, then we have already shown that t always has an eigen value. But this need not happen. There is no guarantee that t to the power k v is equal to v for some v. So let's finally get into the last case. So yeah, I think I'll rub this part because I'm going to start something fresh.
But we are almost done actually. We did all the hard work to prove the last case also. So, t to the power k v is not equal to v for all k. Or it doesn't matter. For all k less than or equal to n. Okay, you will see why I am putting this restriction. Suppose t to the power k v is not equal to v. Then let us again go back to this set. V, t v, t square v up to t to the power n v, where n is equal to the dimension of v.
How many elements are there? There are n plus 1 elements. V, t v, t square v up to t to the power n v, there are n plus 1 elements. What is the dimension of v?
It's n. What does that mean?
This
set is linearly dependent. Correct? So let's write it down. IE A0V plus A1TV plus A2T square V plus up to ANTNV is equal to 0, where not all AI are 0. That is the linear dependence. Okay? So let 1 less than M less than or equal to N be such that AK is equal to 0 for all K greater than M. What I am trying to say is, suppose after AM, all AIs are 0. That's what this means. You should remember, you should observe carefully, A0, so A1 onwards it cannot become 0. Because if that is the case, then A0 times V would be 0 and then V would be 0. But we started off with V not 0. Right? So that's why 1 strictly less than M. So at least these two, one of them should be non-zero. And then let's consider the largest K such that AK is non-zero. Or rather, what this means is that IE, we can write A0B, plus A1TV plus AM T to the power M V is equal to 0, where AM is not 0.
Oh.
And AK AM is not equal to 0. Yeah.
Unless I write this, what I just said will not make sense. So I want AM to be non-zero, and after that let everything be 0. Okay? That means this up to this is such that AM is 0, but after that it is 0. It can happen, right? AN is 0, right? We just need some dependence. It can very well happen that AN is 0, AN minus 1 is 0. It could just be something like TV minus A2, TV minus T square V is 0, something like that. That could be the relationship. We don't know what the exact linear dependence is. However, we can certainly ensure that there is some M such that AK is 0 for all K greater than M and AM is not 0 and K is strictly greater than 1 and less than or equal to M. Yeah, so if you have not understood this part, I can explain it later. We will move on. However, a moment's thought should reveal this to you. Okay, so I can write it like this. This means, so I will just now rewrite this. This is basically A0i plus A1t plus AMt to the power m of V is 0. I am just rewriting this. This implies P of t of V is 0, where P of x is equal to A0 plus A1x plus up to AMx to the power m. Okay? Now we will do the same trick as the previous case. What is P of x? P of x is some polynomial of degree m over the complex numbers. In other words, I can write it as x minus lambda 1 times x minus lambda 2 up to x minus lambda m. Right? So now P of t then will become t minus lambda 1 I times t minus lambda 2 I up to t minus lambda n I, lambda m I. This is t minus lambda 1 I times t minus lambda 2 I dot t minus lambda m I of V is equal to 0, where V is not 0. Now we will repeat the argument which we had done previously.
saying that if this is not 0,
let's call it W1, and then the next step we will check. If that is also not 0, we will continue the process till we reach here. But at least here, it should become 0 because the entire thing is 0. Okay? And that ensures by an argument similar to the previous case, P has an eigenvalue that finishes all the cases.
Okay?
So the proof is over.
Okay. Any doubts? So let's move on. So we have seen that lambda is an eigenvalue, or rather if t is an operator, there exists an eigenvalue lambda. So we will work today over complex numbers only. Everything that I will be saying will be in the complex numbers. Okay? Okay, I'm going to rub this. By the way, this particular theorem that we just proved is generally proved using the idea of determinants. So this is that special word which Devakaran was mentioning, does play a big role in proving this theorem. That is an alternate proof. I have not gone into that proof because we did not define what a determinant is formally. So let me mention here that, so there is a polynomial which did come up, right? That a0 plus a1x up to this particular polynomial. This polynomial is also important. So this is something called the minimal polynomial of the operator. So there are, these are all things which have formal names and they also have quite a lot of importance. We do not have the time to really get into the details therein, but yes, I would suggest that you should read up from here on yourself. Okay? Yeah, so basically there are these concepts of characteristic polynomials, minimal polynomials, and yes, determinants, all these things does play a big role in basically linear algebra, which yeah, I have not ventured, or neither of us have ventured into at all. Anyway, the purpose of these talks was to give a very deep conceptual insight into the subject, that the very properties of vector spaces can be used to prove quite a lot of things, including this big result. This was a big result, by the way. Okay? Okay. Okay, so from now, I will call an operator as A, just like how Devakaran was doing. Okay, so let me fix a vector space. Let V be a vector space of dimension n over C, over the complex numbers, specifying n. This is not over reals. Okay, let T, or let me just say A, belong to L of V. What is this? This is isomorphic to, we have proven that this is isomorphic to MN of C. So I am just writing one N here because it's N cross N. Okay? That means we can think of A as A11, A1N, AN1 or to ANN. The entries. Okay? Okay, so let me write this as A11, only the diagonal elements in N, that is 0 above, 0 below. Okay? Plus, I am now working here in MNC. this is plus. Now here it will be 0 in the diagonal. And this is basically A12 up to A1n, A21, A23 up to A2n, AN1 up to AN-1, this will be So what I am doing is, I am just extracting out the diagonal elements into this matrix and the non-diagonal elements into this matrix. Okay? So let me call this matrix D because it is a diagonal matrix. A and let me call it B. Okay? Okay, good. So I have made. Now let's see. Now define A epsilon to be equal to D plus epsilon times B. Okay? Where 0 is less than or equal to epsilon, which is less than or equal to 1. Any confusion? This is a new definition. So what I am doing is, I will define epsilon here. Epsilon is some real number which is between 0 and 1. When I am multiplying epsilon here, it will be point wise multiplication and we get epsilon times 0 is 0, epsilon times A12 is epsilon A12, epsilon times A1n is epsilon A1n. So if you just check what this matrix is, okay, just give an indicator of what A epsilon is, I can write it in terms of A. What is A epsilon? Check. Actually, this is not a check, this is a direct, something which you can see directly. This will be A11, then epsilon times A12, then epsilon times A1n, epsilon times A21, A22, there is no epsilon here, epsilon times A23, epsilon times A2n. Epsilon times AN1, epsilon times AN-1. Did I make a mistake while writing it here? No. And then ANN. This is exactly what A epsilon will look like. Okay? I am not really interested in how the matrix looks. I will just look at A epsilon to be like this. Okay? Okay, so tell me what is A0? Yeah, don't look there. Look here. It is D, yes. Right? Good. Now what is D? D is A11, A22 up to ANN in the diagonal. Okay. So, let's now look at D. D is basically this. Okay? So, what are the eigenvalues of D? Question mark. What are the eigenvalues of a diagonal matrix? This is a diagonal matrix, right? What are the eigenvalues of a diagonal matrix? Yes? Yes, the diagonal entries. Simple. We just need to check if EI is a standard basis. The standard basis, then observe AEI. So here, not A, DEI. DEI, what will it be? No, it will not be 0, 0. So So what is EI? So this is basically A11, A22, ANN. And what is EI? This is 0, 0, there is a 1 in the EI-th place and 0 elsewhere.
So the multiplication.
Thank you. I didn't write this. Yeah. You observe this is just going to be equal to 0 AII 0. Right? This is AII times EI. In other words, AII turns out to be an eigenvalue of D for all I's. So my observation here is this collection ANN are the eigenvalues of D. D is the same as A0. Okay. So for epsilon equal to 0, we know what the eigenvalues are. Okay? Right? Okay. What is A1? A epsilon is D plus epsilon times B. So what is A1? It is D plus B. What is D plus B? What is D plus B? A. Yes. So basically, A0 to, if epsilon is going from 0 to 1, we are going from this diagonal matrix to the matrix we started off with. Okay? We know what the eigenvalues of A0 is. Okay, so the next theorem, which would be the last theorem in this mini course, would be to see how the eigenvalues of A, or where eigenvalues of A lie with respect to the eigenvalues of D, which happen to be A11 to ANN, which happen to be the diagonal elements of A. Okay? Okay. So let me write the result. You will see that, okay, so before that, let me just define something. Define Ri, let me put a dash, Ri dash of A to be sum of mod Aij j equal to 1 to n and j not equal to I. So basically you take the non-diagonal elements in a row, look at its absolute value and look at the sum. Or in other words, you take B, look at the sum of the rows, absolute value of the rows, and then call it Ri prime of A. Okay. What else do I need? Yeah. So let me now state a theorem. This theorem is due to Gerst-Gorin. Okay. Not important. If you are finding this name very strange, just leave it. No problem. But theorem is due to Gerst-Gorin. So what does this theorem say? So the setup is the same. So let. Okay. So I will not write too many things. A, B, an M cross N matrix. M cross, what M cross? N cross N. N cross N matrix. Okay. Let me not do that. Let us stick to the language of operators and actors. P, B,
is again a linear operator on V. So let V be a
finite dimensional vector space over C. If T is given by A11 up to A1n, with respect to a basis which we will fix once and for all, with respect to a basis which we have fixed for eternity. Okay, then this is the conclusion of the theorem. Eigenvalues of T belong in the union of the closed ball.
Okay, I will
need a little more space. It will lie in the union of the closed ball around mod Aii and radius Ri prime of A. Close. You understand what balls, closed balls are in the complex plane? It is a set of all complex numbers z such that mod of z minus mod Aii is less than or equal to Ri prime of A. Okay, this is the radius of the ball. This is the center of the ball. Okay, this is the theorem. Let's try and prove it. So this is a very powerful result. What does it say? Okay, what it says is, you just look at the diagonal elements of any given matrix or any given operator and look at its matrix. You look at the diagonal elements, look at its modulus which lies on the real axis, then in n balls, so this union is from I is equal to 1 to n, in n balls around these diagonal elements all eigenvalues should belong. That's what this theorem says. It's actually telling us, it's giving us a lot of information. It tells us where the eigenvalues are. Okay, so basically A0, we knew exactly where the eigenvalues were, and now we are able to say where the eigenvalues of A are. Okay, with respect to Ais. Okay, so let's see the proof.
Proof, as it turns out, is going to be very, very simple.
Proof.
Suppose lambda is an eigenvalue. If lambda is an eigenvalue,
we just need to show that lambda belongs to this set. And we will be finished with the proof, right? Okay, so what is the meaning of lambda being an eigenvalue?
I.e. there exists some v non-zero such that tv is equal to lambda v. There, we will write v in terms of that basis. v1 up to vn.
Okay? Now V1 up to Vn are complex numbers. So what we will do is, let P,
so 1 less than or equal to P less than or equal to N, one of the integers between 1 and N, be such that mod of Vp is equal to the maximum of 1 less than or equal to I less than or equal to N, not A, not A, VI.
basically it is, let me not use jargon, this is exactly what it is. So you look at mod Vp to be the P such that it is the maximum amongst the coordinates. Okay? Good. Okay. So now let us analyze what TV looks like. So what is TV? TV is equal to lambda V. So let me write it here. So TV equal to lambda V. And what is lambda V? TV is equal to lambda V1, lambda V2 up to lambda Vn. Correct? That's how it is. Now left hand side is this T acting on V. Correct? Let's look at the Pth column there. This P. We fixed, or rather we found out a particular P. The Pth column. Of TV. So what is TV? TV is A11V1 plus up to A1nVn. That's the first coordinate. Second coordinate is A21V1 plus up to A2nVn. The Pth coordinate will be, yes, AP1V1 plus APnVn. So, however, the Pth column of TV, what is it here? Lambda Vp. This is equal to lambda Vp, right? Okay. So, I will take that in particular in the middle somewhere, there should be a plus APP Vp plus dot dot dot, right? The sum, somewhere there is an APPVP, right? AP1V1 plus AP2V2, APPVP plus APP plus 1, VP plus 1 and so on, right? So let's take this, that side. What we will have is lambda minus APP. Okay, so I am going to strengthen this result. I'm going to say that you don't need the modulus. Okay? In fact, we are telling something more. It's not necessarily in the modulus. I just realized it while writing the proof. You'll see. A lambda minus AP times VP is equal to AP1V1 plus up to AP P minus 1 VP minus 1 plus AP P plus 1 Vp plus 1 plus up to APnVn. Right? So let me write this in a more compact form. This is basically summation mod APJ Vj j equal to 1 to n j not equal to p. Okay? Just writing it in a more compact form. Okay, now let's look at the modulus. Mod of this is mod of this, which is the mod of this. Now let me apply triangle inequality. This is mod of a sum. This is going to be less than or equal to the sum of the modulus of each entry. What is the modulus of each entry? Mod of APJ VJ. But what is mod of APJ VJ? It is mod of APJ times mod VJ. Now, how was Vp picked? Mod Vp is the max of all this. So, in particular, mod Vj is less than or equal to mod Vp for all j. Right? So this is less than or equal to summation mod of Apj. Yeah, so, this is j not equal to p. That condition is there. Okay?
Yeah. So there is no j. J not equal to p is important. You should find that.
J not equal to P, J going from 1 to N, mod of APJ times mod VP.
Because each VJ, each mod VJ
is less than or equal to mod Vp. Right? So I can take this out. This is some common term. So anyway, so what, let me just write down, there were many steps. Finally, what did I derive? This is also this mod times this mod. So basically what we have is mod of lambda minus, or I will write it the other way because it's the same. Mod of APP minus lambda times mod of VP is less than or equal to sum mod APJ times mod VP. And this is basically J equal to 1 to N, J not equal to P. Correct? Okay, good. What can we say about mod VP? We can say at least that mod Vp is non-zero. Why? Because this is the maximum. If mod Vp is 0, then that would mean each mod Vi is 0. That would mean that V is 0. But V is started off as an non-zero eigenvector. Therefore, mod Vp is non-zero. Hence, we can cancel this off. We can divide it by mod Vp, which is a positive quantity, and the equality holds. But what is this? Now let me recall what the definition of Ri prime of A was. It was the sum of all elements of the row with the diagonal entry deleted. In other words, in that notation, this is basically Rp prime of A. Right? But what are we looking at? We are looking at lambda mod of APP minus lambda is less than or equal to Rp prime of A. In other words, lambda belongs to the closed ball of radius Rp prime of A with a center APP. Correct? We have proved the result. No, P was not arbitrary. P was that particular P, which is the maximum. So it was not arbitrary. Yes, we can actually, however, say a little more like Divakaran said. There was nothing special about taking rows. We could have as well taken the columns and worked. It could have happened that if Ci prime of A was the sum of the columns, that could have been smaller than Ri prime of A, and you would have got better bounds on the radius. So you can say slightly better as being in the intersection. But anyway, let's just stick to the rows, and this completes the proof. Okay, so I think this is a very good place to stop. So is there any doubt, or are there any doubts? Yes, so in that case, let's formally call it the closure of this program. I hope you have benefited from it. If you have any doubts, we are still there for some more time. You can talk to us. Yeah. Oh, very good. I stopped at exact 12. Okay, so thank you very much.